Hello. Tonight we are going to be talking about Ping the Snirkelly People. And we're going to speak with Evelyn Adams. Julia and Evelyn will be on shortly.
Hi, Aya.
Hi, Julia. Do you like my new setup in Orchard House?
Yeah, I like it. That's a very nice background.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting, too, because you can talk a little bit about what room in Orchard House is this?
Well, this is the living room in Orchard House, and I can spin around a little
bit. Nice. Well, I like the wicker chairs. It's pretty... Nice setup. So I sent Evelyn the link, and hopefully I'm going to check the email again to see if she has responded again. She hasn't responded a second time, so maybe she's just walking herself through the steps.
Yeah, that's good. We're going to be talking with her about her narration of... Oh, there you are.
Hi, Evelyn.
Hi, Aya. How are you doing today?
Just fine. How are you, Evelyn?
I'm doing well, yes. Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited to finally get a chance to speak to you. Yes, mm-hmm. Yes. Okay, go ahead.
It's nice to meet you. So should I get started by reading Evelyn's bio and then just starting with a few questions?
That would be wonderful.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, sure. Evelyn Adams became an avid reader at the age of 8 when she was first introduced to the wonderful world of Roald Dahl. Anyway, sorry. Books have always been her passion and inspiration, leading her to her first Young Authors Award when she was 13. Evelyn resides in Toronto, Canada, and is an English teacher by day and a narrator by night for her little daughter. So... That's really interesting. And I guess the first question that I have, who was the inspiration for Ping's voice?
Yes. When I was doing the audition for the book, I have a little daughter. She's 5 years old. She's in kindergarten and she's learning to read. So I channeled her. So she was the inspiration. Like, she's very soft spoken, but headstrong. And that's how I, when I read about Ping, that's how I saw her.
Oh wow!
It was my daughter. It's actually, yeah, I'm basically mimicking my daughter's voice when I'm doing Ping.
Well, you did a great job. You beat out some other very excellent creators.
Oh, thank you so much, Aya. That's so nice to hear. Thank you. Hey.
Yeah, that's. I think I can tell why, because you have a very nice speaking voice. So,
Thank you. What led you to
to be a narrator, like, what was the inspiration behind that?
It's funny, like, I don't have like an inspirational story. Like, I do love reading books. I was just online googling, you know how you go on Amazon and you Google books, and of course Facebook tracks everything that you do. So it was actually a Facebook ad that drew me in. It was like right there in the middle of my news feed about narrating audiobooks, and I had never before thought of this type of work. And I thought, okay, I love to read. Why not try narrating them? So that's how like this world opened up. And I took some online courses. I registered for some online courses. And I really thought, you know what, this is something I could do. I could turn my passion for reading into narrating. So that's how I got started. It was it was through Facebook.
Well, I'm curious about the online courses. Did
yes.
they teach you the more technical aspects of how to record?
Yes, exactly. That's what they went into detail with. It was the very basic course that I did. I could even share the link with you like later on. And they taught me like, you know, the software and how to narrate and the technical aspects, yes, to edit and process your audio. Of course, there's a lot more master classes, but I started with the basic just to get an understanding and to get started. You can get started right away just by doing a basic course. That's how easy it is.
So I guess there's another question. Does being an English teacher help you with your job as a narrator? What are some of the perks?
Yeah, it does, because I mostly teach children, and of course you have to be super creative whenever you're presenting them with some sort of information. So one of the first advice that I actually got was when you're narrating, pretend that you are, it's basically you're having a conversation. Someone is in front of you. So I always visualize my class, my children, like my students. They are my inspiration. So I basically imagine they're in front of me. And the whole time when I was narrating Ping, that's what I did. I was telling the story to them. So it made it more real, because you're stuck in a little studio. And, you know, it just made it so much easier. And I was basically visualizing them and talking to them. And it came out more natural. Like, you know, it's not just reading. You have to be able to talk to them. That's how you narrate. Like, you're having a conversation. Like, you're telling a story. So that's how it helps me. Helps me visualize.
Definitely. That makes sense. Do you have, like, an Instagram page or a Twitter page where you promote your services as a narrator? So
I will start. I will start, like, I don't currently, but I'm definitely going to start marketing myself and, like, my services, yes. I don't have at the moment.
Good.
Yes, yeah.
That's okay. I was just curious, so yeah. If people were interested.
Of course, yeah, yeah.
So do you speak any languages besides English, I was wondering?
Do I speak any other? I can read Spanish, and I can speak like Urdu and Punjabi. Oh. I can speak those languages, yes.
Are those your home languages?
Like, they're my parents' native languages. Yes. I guess, yeah, by default they're mine as well. But I'm Canadian.
Nice.
So I've heard about Toronto. It's a pretty interesting city.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about Toronto? If you're a tourist coming to the city, like things that that you would recommend maybe for people with kids that they might like to do?
Mm-hmm. Of course, yeah. The first thing, well, it's not in Toronto, but it's Niagara Falls. That's a big thing in Canada. We always, like, you cannot visit Canada without having seen Niagara Falls. And specifically Toronto, yeah, the CN Tower. We have the Toronto Zoo. Then there's the Royal Museum. So there's lots of things to do. And so many different cultures. You will see so many different people, like GTA. Well, GTA is known as the Greater Toronto Area. And you will find something from all over the world in Toronto. It's just a mix of cultures. It's a beautiful, lively city. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yes.
So, do you have another book that's coming up that you're going to be narrating in the future, like what you can speak of, or is that something that you're not allowed to speak of until they're published?
Oh, nothing like that, but I'm currently working on two projects. Like, I do fiction and nonfiction, so I'm currently working on a nonfiction. Yeah.
What's the topic about? Are you allowed to disclose that?
Yeah, of course. The nonfiction that I'm working on, it's about, like, religious studies. Yeah. So that's the project I'm currently working on.
Interesting.
Yes.
Yeah. So would you do more children's books?
Yes, for sure. Yeah, they're way more interesting. Yes, exactly. They're more my passion, like fiction and especially children's books. I feel like you discover your own talents as you're narrating, and I feel that my voice is more suited towards children's books. Like, it's hard for me to make, like, a, you know, like a manly voice or like a husky voice. So I can easily do children's characters. Like, I have a softer voice, right? So I find it harder to do, like, the other types of narrations. Yeah. So definitely this is my, like, this is the stream that I want to follow. Children's books.
Yeah. It's good to have strength, and I can.
But there's not that many. Yeah, but there's not that many though. There's not that many. I found Aya's book, and I was like so excited when I auditioned for it. It was amazing. But there's not so many, right, Aya? Like, as you look on ACX website, you don't tend to find too many children's books.
Yeah,
For narration. Well, that's interesting. Yes. I wasn't aware of that. I write both for adults and for children. Mm-hmm. So I have three children's books. I mean, one is already out there. It's called In Case There's a Box.
Yes.
It's narrated by Patrick Hahn. Mm-hmm. And I have another audiobook coming out about the same time as He Will Be Ready. Okay. And it is When Sword Met Bow, and so it's actually about my daughter and Bow, that I raised. So, and I find that there are, you know, there are a lot of narrators who like to read children's books.
Yes.
But it's just perfect for Ping. So you beat everybody.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. I really appreciate that.
So, I guess. I don't want to, like, give too much away. Do you think there would ever be a sequel to Ping, or was Ping a standalone book? And then
I was wondering the same thing. I was also wondering. I would love to have a sequel.
I don't see one coming. It's really the events the catalyst for me to write that book took, like, 40 years because, you know, it builds on events that happened in my life when I was 6 years old. But then it had to percolate because I didn't look back on it in this way until I myself found myself again being a stranger in a strange land. And I was teaching at the university level in Taiwan. And suddenly I was taken back to the last time I had to do that to be immersed in a culture that I wasn't used to. And then I realized I had to write this story.
Yes. It's a beautifully written story. I loved every page, every chapter. Yes.
So what is your favorite part of Ping? Like, what scene would you say was the best, like, in your opinion?
You're asking me? Yeah. Definitely the conversations that Olivia and Ping had. And my daughter was the inspiration for Ping's voice. One of her friends was the inspiration for Olivia's voice. Like, when I read about Olivia, she was a little Miss Know-It-All. And that's how one of my friend's daughter, daughter's friends is. Like, she's a little Miss Know-It-All. So definitely the conversations between them. They're innocent, but they're just, they're like miniature adult conversations. So it led me to think, right? They are. Like, they are kids, but, like, the way they are just talking about, especially when they're discussing about God or, you know, about running away, and just the way Ping perceives things, I love to see how it carries out, how what their point of view is and the conversations between them. They were my favorite. The part about running away specifically was my favorite conversation.
Yeah, that was really good. I also like the part where she was speculating about the teacher. Something about the husband and the teacher.
Yes. When she wrote the letter, because of the word infidelity.
Oh yes,
right. Yes. Oh, it was beautifully explained, and how kids take things literally, I guess, right? Because, they see the world a bit differently. That's what drew me into the book from the very first chapter. We were seeing the world through Ping's eyes, through that innocence, the way they see the world. So I loved this book. Yeah. I'm going to read it to my daughter. Yeah.
Would you ever read it to your students as well? Like parts of it?
Or? Yes, of course. Yeah, definitely. It's a great book.
I think it'd be a great book to share with more students. I actually, because I used to teach, but I don't teach any longer, I sent it to a teacher hoping that she would share it with her class, but my friend never got back to me. So I'm hoping more teachers would share the book.
Yes, exactly. And for sure, yeah. I would share it with my class. I might have to explain a couple of the references, right? Because I even had to Google a couple of the references. I didn't know about Underdog. To be honest, I didn't know about Underdog. I had to Google the words, like what it was, because it wasn't, I never saw Underdog. Like, I guess it wasn't during our time, right? But other than that, of course, like, the book is amazing. I would say it's timeless. It has a message for adults and children alike, of course. Even adults, like, sometimes I do also teach ESL classes. So that's why this book attracted me. It's the same for kids and adults, because whether you're learning English as a 5-year-old or as a 45-year-old, you're going through the same process.
Definitely. I actually do think it would be a good book for an ESL student.
Definitely.
Yeah, I think it would even be a good extra book for us to teach how to teach ESL, because
exactly.
The teachers have not been through the experience themselves, and they don't understand what the students
Exactly, like what they're thinking and how they are seeing the words, like especially the part where you broke it down, like duh, guh. And that's exactly how my daughter is learning to read, and she tries to apply that to all the words. And when I read that section in the book, I was like, wow, you nailed it. That's exactly how kids are, you know, they're trying to sound out everything and it's not practical. So it was a beautifully written book with just the most amazing sense of humor. Loved it.
So have you ever been taught narration? Do you think now that you're a narrator, you would also teach some of these online courses? Is that that you would?
Hopefully later on, but not at this stage. I still have so much learning to do. Like, you're always learning as a narrator. Even narrators who've been doing this for like 20 plus years, they're still learning. Like, that's like in their videos, that's what they say. So at this stage, I wouldn't be comfortable teaching, because I feel that I have a lot more to learn before I could give back to the narrating community. But it's something definitely I want to do in the future.
For sure. That's great.
Do you have a YouTube channel where you do sample readings or
No, now I will. On top of Instagram and Twitter, now I'll start doing that. Yeah. I'm not that heavy on social media. Like, I haven't really promoted myself, but definitely I want to expand this into more of a business. Yeah. I will. I don't have a YouTube channel yet, but I will.
As a narrator, I do think Instagram and YouTube, those would both be wonderful.
Exactly.
Yeah, do some small readings maybe from, or sample readings from different books
that I've done, yes, to promote.
So, were there any other topics in the book of Ping that you think would be interesting just for the reader? Like, since you're saying that you had to Google certain things, like, any certain topics that you think would need to be explained a little bit to the reader, since it is for a younger audience, just as a narrator, that would be good for them to know more about?
Maybe just the advertisements. I remember, like, the pledge commercial. Like, when the book talked about the pledge and stuff, I had to Google that as well. So maybe just the advertising, those parts. Nothing else comes to mind. So there was Underdog I had to look up. There was the pledge advertisements. Like, I couldn't find one of the lyrics of some of the advertisements. That was it. And I guess maybe the presidents of... Right? Like, if we're talking about Kennedy, we're talking about Johnson. Maybe to a very, very younger generation, we might have to explain to them a little bit. Yeah.
And even if they knew who it was, they wouldn't have lived through Kennedy's assassination going into Johnson, knowing what that era was like. And also the fact that it was during the Vietnam War, which was very controversial. They wouldn't have that.
They wouldn't have that sort of backup. Exactly. Yeah. So just that context.
You know, there were some things that were, I don't think people do that anymore, or there are rules like that. Yeah. That what I described was the girls had to wear dresses.
Yes, yeah.
The girls had to go into the playground through the boys' side, but they weren't supposed to play on the boys' side. I don't think we have that anymore, so that would also probably...
You know, for a second I forgot that this was in America, and I thought, is this like some Asian country? And then that's a good point.
My mom, high school, they had to wear dresses, but everybody wore mini skirts, and it was strange because they it just felt very strange that you always had to wear a dress and it was a mini skirt. Yeah, I don't know. Like, I know that's the rule, but the year before they could wear pants, but all of a sudden they passed the rule the next year. It was kind of strange. Like, I don't know.
Like, this was a public school, like in a public school, but
this was a public school in Kansas, and when girls started wearing pants to school, they passed the rule saying no, you could not wear pants, you had to wear skirts, and it was in the late 60s. So, but I think most girls wore skirts up until like 69, so they never had a rule for that, but they actually implemented the rule that year. It was just kind of strange, but I know other schools had a rule that you always had to wear dresses anyway up until like 1972, I think, here in California. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, here in California, I wasn't growing up in that era, but I guess in the early 70s, like, you could start wearing pants to school, but I believe that they all had to wear skirts up until like 1972, 73 here in Southern California, which was kind of surprising to me.
So was it a uniform? Like, were they uniforms or just like dress codes? Like,
It was a dress code, but it was just a very strange dress code Yeah, like to me, it just seemed very odd that, okay, I think it had to do with the fact that women were always wearing dresses to school.
Dresses, skirts,
up until like the late 60s when they started wearing pants and the bell bottoms. But around that time, the administrator just made this rule saying you can't wear pants to school except on Friday.
Okay.
It was kind of an arbitrary rule. That was
random.
Yeah, but I have never heard of another school like that. Like, most of the schools, they always had to wear skirts anyway up until the 70s. This was just kind of, it's kind of strange, but who knows why.
Yeah, that was a little different, too, yeah, when I read that.
Yeah.
But again, that's what just adds to the story. It takes you, when you're reading Ping, you kind of get transported to that time as well, right? So I really loved reading from that era, from that perspective, and then how life was like.
Yeah, definitely. So your parents, did they grow up here in the U.S. or did they immigrate
Canada.
When they were in Canada? So they grew up in Canada. Sorry, you're from Canada. I'm sorry.
Okay. That's absolutely fine. Yeah.
So they grew up in Toronto, Canada, or when they were younger, or did they come as adults after they
younger?
Went to
when they were younger. Yeah, they grew up.
They grew up there. So they don't really have a context of having been in another country or anything.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly. Yeah.
Interesting. That's pretty neat. But you just learn like Urdu. It just was a cultural thing, like to maintain the language. I just found that fascinating. the reason was I'm part Syrian. My grandfather was Syrian, like born here in the U.S. and he spoke Arabic. But by my parents' generation, nobody learned the language. Like, they were just so assimilated that they didn't teach their kids the language. So I like how some communities continue the traditions and languages.
Yeah, and we have like a big South Asian community in the GTA area, in like the Toronto area. So it's that community is pretty strong. So it's easy to pick up, especially in schools too. Like in the public schools, there's a lot of Punjabi and like Urdu being spoken like by the kids. And like they're really... all those holidays are also being celebrated, like especially when those events come up, then all the kids do activities like Diwali and stuff like that. So they do those activities, they carry out those celebrations in school as well. So that culture has been kept alive, and that's in the GTA area. That's where that's why I say like it's a wonderful place to grow up.
Yeah, so
you end up retaining a lot of it, even if you didn't grow up in that country. You end up retaining it. Because it's very much alive.
I feel like I kind of missed out on that. So do you think you could narrate a book, like maybe based on a celebration such as Diwali or something like that? Have you looked for maybe doing some cultural books such as that?
Yeah, I would love to. I haven't come across any, but given the opportunity, I would love to do that for sure. Especially Go ahead.
Write it. I mean, I think you said in your bio that you also write. Is that right?
Yes. I mostly write poetry, but when I was younger, actually, I used to write. Now I have to especially make time. I haven't written for a while, but that is my passion. So I try to write poetry just to stay in touch with that. But I used to write short stories, even as a kid. I used to do that, yes. But now I narrate.
What are your poems about? Can you give us an example of a poem?
Oh, what I wrote about. Oh, of a poem. Oh, my goodness. I love writing about nature. I don't have a sample with me. Like, I don't, like, especially haikus and stuff. I got inspired by one of my English teachers in high school in writing, like, free prose, like, poetry. So I mostly write about nature. That's what I like.
Yes. Nature is a good topic.
It is. It's inspirational. It's soothing. It helps. It's like my way of meditation. I like it.
I do think haiku is a form of meditation. I remember when we had a teacher that taught us the haikus with I haven't written one in a very long time, but I think it was five syllables and seven syllables five. That cool?
Yes, yeah, five. Yeah. Five. And it doesn't have to rhyme, so it makes it easy. Making things rhyme is hard. Yeah,
for sure.
It's nice. I mean, you can really just let your feelings flow, right, through those words and through writing poetry.
So as a teacher, do you think, like, you would have your kids maybe do a project where they would write, like, some short stories and practice narration so they could become better?
Oh, yeah, of course. Yes, exactly. That's definitely a good way to do that. It brings out their creative side, and then they're able to present the story, like, maybe in a play form or like a skit form. Yeah, like I grew up doing that in high school, so I kind of try to mimic the same thing that my teachers had us do. So I take a lot of inspiration from the projects that I did growing up. Like, they're timeless, they're classic, so I use some of the same techniques because that's what really helped me and got me into reading. I started reading back in, like, I think second grade or something. And like I said, Roald Dahl was the first author I read, and in his book, James and the Giant Peach, that's what I read first and got me into reading. Yes, I got my first library card, and yes. I want to instill that passion into kids, reading, actually picking up physically a book and reading, you know, not just...
Oh, definitely.
That's. I want them to have that passion.
Do you guys have any public libraries in the Toronto area?
Of course. Yes.
Yeah, and they have some good summer reading programs that might.
Yes. They do. Yeah, I send my daughter there. They have amazing summer reading programs. And like I said, because it is a diverse community, in the library they also have sections like books written in different languages. Like Chinese and Punjabi and Urdu, and like, yeah, they have those sections too. And then of course they have summer programs. Yeah. Libraries are every neighborhood has its own library, like its own community center, and which has a library in it. So that those are not hard to find.
That's very impressive, because some cities actually will have one or two libraries, but it's not enough per, you know, student or person, from what I've heard, or far distance away. Ours is pretty good in California, but like I've heard some cities in Texas, like you have to drive.
Oh, really? Okay.
I've just read that, but I never lived in Texas, so I couldn't say that for certain. But it sounds like Toronto. Sorry, go ahead, Aya.
I did live in Texas. We had libraries.
Maybe didn't have many. I don't know. That you had to drive an hour, but...
No. I lived in a small town called Grand Prairie, Texas, and we had a library, and I used to spend a lot of time there reading the Brontes, you know, Emily and Charlotte.
Yes.
And reading their biographies, too.
Right, exactly. And one of my first jobs as a teenager when I was in high school, it was working at a library. I didn't want to work anywhere else. Like, I went straight into a library. I'm like, do you have a job for me? I love books. I want to work in a library. I want to be surrounded by books. That's how I landed my first job. I was a page at a library because I loved books. And they just saw that in my, like, when I was interviewing and they hired me. I had no, like, prior experience. So libraries have always, like, I've always been drawn to libraries. Books, the written word. I love it. Yeah.
So did you want to share anything else about your narrating experience before we end or anything?
I think you've pretty much covered everything. I just wanted to thank Aya for giving me this wonderful opportunity. And I loved every moment of it. And the book will be out soon. Yes, I'm almost done, just like putting the final touches on it, and I'll have it uploaded.
Okay, yes, very soon.
Beginning of next week, for sure. Before the deadline. I'm pretty much done. I'm just going over each chapter. I want to make sure it's perfect.
Thank you. You're doing it yes. now.
Yes, because I know it's your baby, right? I want to take care of it.
Yes,
it is.
My baby.
Yes, it's amazing. Yeah, I can't wait for it to hit Audible and yeah, and for it to be available to the public. I have a question for you, Aya. Will you be writing more children's books? Like, are you working on more books?
Well, I have a few that I have actually written. And the thing with my children's books, they're always a little bit tricky because there's always the adult level that you can read them on as well as the children's level. So there's one that's in verse, and it's called Banned from Lunch, as in not allowed to go to lunch.
Oh, okay.
And there's another one, it's called The Little Boy Who Didn't Catch a Fish.
Okay.
And that one is about failure. It's kind of intended to, it's intended to be an antidote to the little engine that could, because you know, sometimes you try your very hardest at something and you try over and over again and you don't give up and you still don't succeed. And there's no book to help you to deal
yes.
with that.
Well, that's amazing. That's beautiful. Yeah. So you're working on that?
Well, yeah, they exist. They haven't been published. They were available. I mean, they're not available, but they're...
Okay.
It's not like I'm writing them. I just haven't decided yet
what to publish. I see. Okay. That's good to know. Yeah.
So it was really nice meeting you, Evelyn, and hearing about your work.
Thank you.
I'm excited to hear about or to hear the narration from
Thank you very much.
Thank you for sharing and have a good night, everybody.
Thank you very much. Good night. Bye. Bye, Aya. Bye, Jane. Thank you very much for having me.